Babylonian demise. Revelation chapters 14 and 16 have already declared Babylon has fallen. Now in chapters 17 and 18, the fall of Babylon is carefully detailed for us. So let's pray together as we begin. Heavenly Father, I thank you for grace and mercy that you extend to us moment by moment oftentimes. Heavenly Father, today as we open up your word, I trust, I believe, and I know that you will open our hearts and our minds to receive it. That, Lord God, that you will speak to us about the word. Father, we know that a lot of this is going to be futuristic to us. We're not going to be there for this. But the purpose of us knowing it is so that we can have confidence in who you are and what you're going to do. And Father, we can warn others of the coming Holocaust that is about to befall the human race in short period of time. So Lord, bless us today as we read and study your word. And Father, I pray for the anointing of it on me as a speaker and on all of us as hearers of your word, that you would have your way in our hearts and in our lives. And it's in Christ's name we pray. And all God's kids said, amen. You know, as we look at this detailed for us, the concept of Babylon is even greater than what we see in Revelation 17 and 18 with the reign of the Antichrist. Babylon was present in John's day. It was typified by the Roman Empire. And it's in our day and throughout history, it is present as a world religious, political, and economic system. But under the Antichrist, Babylon, in both its religious and commercial aspects, will have influence over the entire earth as never before. If you missed Lex's study this morning on John Mark, I invite you to come into Sunday school because he's opening the scriptures and we can see preludes sometimes of what has already happened to what is going to happen. And it was a great discussion this morning, Lex, and I appreciate all that you do. Babylon dates back to Genesis chapter 10 and the building of the Tower of Babel. You're familiar with that. And the man Nimrod. According to the records of ancient Babylon, Nimrod's wife, and her name is Semiramis, was known in Egypt as Isis. And in Greece, she was known as Aphrodite, and in Rome, Venus, and was the first high priestess of idolatry. According to the legend, she conceived a son named Tammuz, who as a man was killed but 40 days was resurrected from the dead, as the message goes. But the mother-child cult that spread throughout the ancient world was detrimental. In Phoenicia, this counterfeit god was known as Baal. In Egypt, Isis or Orus. And in Greece, Aphrodite. And in Rome, Venus or Cupid. The religious cult developed a liturgy of worship, offering wafers to the priestess as the queen of heaven, with 40 days of abstinence known as Lent, memorializing the 40 days celebrating the resurrection of Tammuz. Part of this resurrection was celebrated by exchanging Ishtar eggs, symbolizing new life. Our word today of Esther comes from that word. We find references to this pagan religion in the Old Testament, where Jeremiah sharply condemns the nation Israel for the worship of the Queen of Heaven. In Jeremiah chapter 44, verses 15 through 18, it reads, "Then all men who knew that their wives were burning incense to other gods, along with all the women who were present, a large assembly, and all the people living in the lower and upper Egypt, said to Jeremiah, 'We will not listen to the message you have spoken to us in the name of the Lord. We will certainly do everything we said we would. We will burn incense to the Queen of Heaven and pour out offerings just as we said and as our ancestors, our kings, and our officials did in towns of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem. At that time, we had plenty of food and were well off and suffered no harm. But ever since we stopped burning incense to the Queen of Heaven and pouring out drink offerings to her, we have had nothing and have been perishing by the sword and famine.'" This world religious cult started in Babylon. It ended in ended up in Rome under Pontius Maximus, the high priest of Rome. When Constantine made Christianity the official religion in Rome in 325 AD, many pagan temples and practices were adopted as Christian worship. It was then that the first pope of Rome assumed the title Pontius Maximus from his pagan predecessor. Some of the practices, such as Queen of Heaven, Purgatory, Holy Water, Priestly Absolution, Bells and Candles, Celibacy of Priests, and Dedicated Virgins were all pagan practices of Babylonian religion. Some large segments of Christendom actually have their roots in the pagan mystery religion of Babylon and not the Word of God. Revelation 17, verse 4, speaks of Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes, and of the abominations of the earth. This appears here because the Antichrist is going to revive the Babylonian false cult and marry it to the satanic political system during the tribulation. In these two chapters of Revelation 17 and 18, the Roman Babylonian religious system is going to be destroyed along with the revived ancient city of Babylon itself. The pagan system, which is both religious and political, is described as the woman in the text. And at the end of John's vision, we see the beast turn up the woman and ravage her. The Antichrist is only using this religious system for his own purposes to promote his own program. So while in Revelation 17 deals with religious Babylon, using the image of a wicked and perverse woman sitting on a scarlet beast, Revelation 18 commercialized Babylon. It's shown as a lure of luxury and riches that enticed the world's leaders to commit fornication with her. Here John describes the demise of the world economic system. God does not bring judgment upon a sinful world without first giving repeated warnings that are justified. Today, God is still giving us warnings, isn't he? We have not entered the Great Tribulation, and yet God still is giving people warnings of what is to come. He warns it through his message of the Scriptures. He warns it through the preaching. He warns it from you learning about these things and sharing them with neighbors and friends and lost people to let them know what is coming in the future. We're given four specific reasons for the destruction of Babylon. The Babylonian economic system is judged because of her influence, her iniquity, her infidelity, and her inhumanity. Verses 1 through 3 describe the lament over fallen Babylon as she is judged because of her wicked influence that causes others to follow her immorality. In Revelation 18, verse 1, it reads, "After this I saw another angel coming down from heaven, and he had a great authority, and the earth was illuminated by his splendor. With a mighty voice he shouted, 'Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling for demons and a haunt for every impure spirit, a haunt for every unclean bird, a haunt for every unclean and detestable animal. For all the nations have drunk the maddening wine of her adulteries. The king of the earth committed adultery with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her excessive luxuries.'" The term 1 hour, as that we see in verse 19, is sometimes translated as a period of time. But here, the word fallen is one that means to fall instantaneously. There was no delay in it. Verse 19 tells us of the demise of Babylon, that it will take place very possibly and literally in a very short period of time, stated as in 1 hour. whether it's literal or symbolic, it happens quickly. The beginning of this in verse 4, we're told that the sins of Babylon have reached the heavens and God has remembered her iniquities. Follow with me in that verse. Then I heard another voice from heaven say, "Come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues, for her sins are piled up to heaven." The King James says, reached heaven. "And God has remembered her crimes." The verb for reach means to glue or to weld something together, meaning that Babylon's sins have been stacked, going higher and higher like bricks cemented together until they reach the God of heaven. This is another obvious reference to Genesis chapter 11, to the building of the Tower of Babel. In verse 7 of this chapter, we're told of Babylon's infidelity. It says, "In her heart she boasts, 'I sit enthroned as queen. I am not a widow. I will never mourn.'" Babylon's words here indicate that she considers herself immortal and invincible, literally out of the reach of God. It's a shame that even today, many people who deny that there is a God, or deny that there is a hell and no judgment, deny that there are no consequences for the way they live, feel like they're literally out of reach of God and that He cannot touch them. Well, she lives in the iniquity and boasts of it, having no fear of anyone who might hold her accountable. Her words remind us of Satan's words when he boasted that he would become like the Most High God. So Babylon is judged because of her spiritual infidelity, setting herself up as ruler of the earth under the authority of the Antichrist. And finally, Babylon is judged because of her inhumanity. Looking, beginning in verse 11, "The merchants of the earth will weep and mourn over her because no one buys her cargoes anymore. Cargoes of gold, silver, precious stones and pearls, fine linen, purple silk and scarlet cloth, every sort of citron wood, and articles of every kind made of ivory, costly wood, bronze, iron, and marble, cargoes of cinnamon and spice, of incense, myrrh, and frankincense, of wine and olive oil, of fine flour and wheat, cattle and sheep, horses and carriages, and human beings being sold as slaves." Verse 14 continues, "They will say, 'The fruit you long for is gone from you, and your luxury and splendor have vanished, never to be recovered.' The merchants who sold these things and gained their wealth from her will stand far off, terrified at her torment. And they will weep and mourn and cry out, 'Woe, woe to you, great city, distressed in fine linen, purple and scarlet, and glittering with gold, precious stones and pearls. In 1 hour, such a great wealth has been brought to ruin.'" In these verses, we find 28 different articles of merchandise are mentioned. First, there are articles which have first place in the hearts of men, like gold and silver and precious stones. Next, we see articles that show are for show or adornment. And then articles of precious wood, metal, and ivory. And finally in the list, there are more useful items such as horses and chariots. All of these items fall in range of luxury, not necessarily needed for daily living. So Babylon here is characterized by the pursuit of luxury, just as many people pursue luxury today. We live in a country where we really have luxury. If you look at the other countries around the world, most countries, even highly developed countries in Europe. I was looking the other day on television, and I was looking at House Hunters International. Some of you are familiar with that. And I looked at them talking about some of the houses and all in Europe. And I was looking at their houses, and I was thinking, wow, you know, here's their kitchen, and they say this is a fine kitchen. But you know, kitchens in America, even ordinary kitchens, are better equipped with cupboards and cabinetry and appliances than what some of those are. We really are a blessed nation. Amen. And we take it so much for granted. And we think about the things that we have. And I'm just going to make a plug here for missions for just a moment. But we have been blessed as the richest nation on the earth, and God expects us to sow into other countries for the Word of God, to get it to people who are less fortunate. And so when we think about the extra money that you might have in a month and saying, well, I'm going to go to the movie, or I'm going to buy this or that, I want us to stop for just a moment and think about sowing some of what God has blessed us with into kingdom work in other places for other people. So she is judged, and last in this list is the bodies and the souls of men, indicating that mankind will be nothing more than a commodity in these last days. The human trafficking that we see today is only a sampling of what they're going to be seeing in the tribulation period. In the Antichrist economic system, human beings will be dehumanized, which is what happens when God is taken out of the equation. Finally, at the end of the chapter, we see a pitiful reactions of from the judgments of Babylon. In verse 21, it says, "Then a mighty angel picked up a boulder the size of a large millstone, and he threw it into the sea and said, 'With such violence, the great city of Babylon will be thrown down, never to be found again.' The monarchs of the earth will mourn, for they trusted in the dominance they bring with glory and riches and fame. The merchants of the earth will mourn. They trusted in the marketplace for their financial security and prosperity. The mariners will mourn, for they put their trust in their ships to gain wealth, the wealth of Babylon." And then the voice John hears from heaven tells us how we should respond to the judgments and the fall of Babylon. Listen closely. "Come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues. For her sins are piled up to heaven, and God has remembered her crimes. Give back to her as she has given. Pay her back double for what she has done. Pour her a double portion of her own from her own cup. Give her as much torment and grief as the glory and luxury she gave herself." The Bible tells us that in all of this she deserves all of this, because in her heart she boasts, "I sit enthroned as queen, and I am not a widow, and I will never mourn," she says. The command of the people of God is separate themselves from the world is a frequent one that we find in Scripture. One of the best known exhortations of this is seen by the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. There he tells people that to not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Come out from among them and be separate is the command. So there's two reasons for fleeing Babylon. The first is to be separate from the sins of Babylon, from the judgment that is coming upon the whole world system that we see from the Antichrist. The second reason is to flee the escape of the plagues and the judgments that are besetting Babylon. These plagues and judgments will fall on all who follow the Antichrist, all who take the mark of the beast or bow and worship him. We should not think that because the literal Babylon lies in ruins today, that the spirit of Babylon is not alive and well in our society. For us, staying separate from that worldly spirit is the key to our safety today. with Babylon's demise and the fall of the Antichrist, the stage is set for the last chapters of the book of Revelation. And next week we're going to be looking at the four hallelujahs and the glorious reappearing of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
With this message, with this information, we need to take it and carry it out to the world. There are people that drive up and down this road every day. 10,000 cars, I can imagine, on a weekday. And all of those people are coming and going. And some of you are in contact with some of them. And we need to take opportunity to say to them, listen, time is short, and Jesus is coming back soon, and there is to be a great judgment on those who do not follow Christ. Some of them will shake their fist in your face and say, don't give me that religious junk. Others will tell you, I don't want to hear about that. If that's what you've got to talk about, don't talk to me anymore. But there may be one that you mention this to, and they say, oh my. And it'll be that one that the Holy Spirit is speaking to their heart, and they might turn to Christ today because you've taken the message to them. Amen? Amen. Let's stand together as we pray.